Hi, y'all. I'm Charlie Daniels.
Hi, I'm Charlie Daniels Jr., and this is the Charlie Daniels Podcast. From long-haired country boy to simple man, the best there's ever been. I hope y'all enjoyed part one of our interview with Rodney as much as I did. And part two, you're going to love as well. And I've also got something that I've been talking about, kind of teasing now for several episodes, and I can finally talk about it now. So there is some new stuff heading your way, but you're going to have to wait just a little bit longer, not much longer, just to the end of the show, and it will be worth it, I promise. Okay, as I said before, we've been going through some old Facebook Lives and just finding some really cool stuff. People ask questions about different things that he answers and stuff. So just found one. In fact, it was the very first one that we did announcing Never Look at the Empty Seats. And this is him reading the introduction or the preface, as it's called in the book. And it kind of lays the groundwork for the rest of the book. So here you go. Enjoy it.
The proposition of making a living as a professional musician can be confusing and challenging. To take it a step further and join the few who have ascended the slippery slope of the big time is a daunting task, to say the least. After so many years in the business, I guess it's only natural for young men and women who want to chase the dream to ask an old-timer like me questions about the decades I've devoted and the miles I've traveled in my half-century-plus roller coaster ride as a professional musician. The two most frequently asked questions are, how do you make it in the music business, and how do you have a long career like yours? I'm writing this book with two primary thoughts in mind. First of all, I'd like to answer these and other questions. Most of all, I have a story to tell. It's a story about trial and error, hard work, hard times, the myriad of encouraging little things that give you hope and a reason to go on when it seems it's uphill all the way. I want to tell you about the people who have been a part of my life and the miles I've traveled, but most of all, I want to tell you about the music. The creation and performance and the undying love that I have for it and my God-given talent that makes it possible. I'd also like to give you an inside view of what the life of a professional musician is like and a look at the business from my view and attitude. The truth about the music business is there's no yellow brick road to get you there. There's no academic degree that guarantees the success you seek. There's no safety net to catch you when you fall. There's only you, your talent, your determination, and your belief in yourself. And most important of all, your attitude. While, as I said, there's no yellow brick road, there are some time-proven absolutes, many that I've learned the hard way over the years. I'll pass them on to you, laced with a goodly portion of knowledge earned by beating my head against various walls over the years. I've had many unique experiences in my 8-plus decades. I've ridden on everything from an Eskimo dog sled to the Concorde and Air Force One. I've performed in every state in the Union and some 21 foreign countries, in war zones and on an aircraft carrier at sea and on remote forward operating bases where only a few lonely soldiers make up one of the most cherished audiences of all. I've stood at the 38th parallel that separates South and North Korea. Knocked a few chips out of the Berlin Wall and worked cattle with the cowboys in Texas and the buckaroos in Nevada. I've seen the polar ice cap, seen the Negev in Israel, and baptized in the Jordan River and marveled at the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. I've seen whales in the Pacific and watched the Mustang herds run wild and free across the endless expanses of the high desert country. This account is not written in exact chronological order. I tend to jump around a bit in my narrative, relating memories and lessons learned as I recall them, and not always in a proper sequence, reliving times and events as they come to me, one memory prompting another one, one instance remembering, triggering a vivid recollection of something that could well have happened many years on back or on up the road. It's a little different route, I know, but we still end up at the same place. One of life's most important lessons that I've learned as it relates to the path I've chosen is like the old song says, accentuate the positive, eliminate the negatives. Some nights you have more to give than others, but put it all out there at every show. You're concerned with the people who showed up, not the ones who didn't. So always give them a show and never look at the empty seats.
And now a word from our sponsor, the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.
Only two things protect America: the grace of Almighty God and the United States military. Words of wisdom from our founder, the late Charlie Daniels. Hi, my name is David Corlew, co-founder of the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project. From world wars, the Korean conflict, to Vietnam, the Gulf War, and as we experience the drawdown of the 20-year war against terrorism, America has continued to send the best we have into combat, defending the beliefs and the borders of our great nation. When the fighting stops, our men and women who served begin a new mission, their own journey home. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project offers assistance and support in the return, the rehabilitation, and the reintegration back to civilian life. We focus on education, housing, various rehabilitation programs, as well as the tragic epidemic of suicide within our own veterans community, 22 a day. Join our mission in serving those who have served us. Donate now by contacting us at the Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. The Charlie Daniels Journey Home Project.org. Thank you and God bless America.
Right, it's music time. Not teasing music yet, but be sure to keep listening after Rodney, and there will be some information about new releases. See? Told you it'd be worth it. This time we've got an instrumental for you. This is a song that was from the Redneck Fiddlin' Man album, and the Redneck Man does play a mean fiddle, so here's Crosstown Traffic. The song of the show is brought to you by the official CDB website store. I'm wearing one of my favorite designs that we've ever had, the CDB 50th anniversary shirt. It's beautiful. It's a celebration of the CDB 50 years. Hard to believe that it's been 50 years since Dad started touring as the Charlie Daniels Band. But on the back, it has all the albums listed in chronological order. So that's very cool, too. The Devil Went Down to Georgia shirts from Nine Line Apparel. It's a fantastic design. Very cool. Lots of little hidden gems in there to kind of look through. The Drinking My Baby Goodbye 35th Anniversary shirts and koozie. Benghazi Ain't Going Away, and it still ain't going away, no matter what Brandon wants. But also, then If We Need It Here, Make It Here shirts. And we have CDs, we have DVDs, we have books, we have the Idle Strings bracelets that Angela makes. We have this very cool open tile turquoise design that she made. It's the most recent one, and they're going fast. And by listening or watching the podcast, we're sharing discount codes for CDB merchandise. We rotate the codes this month. Is Podcast 5. It will save you 35% on orders at store.charliedaniels.com. Does not count for the Life Fiddle, but we'll talk about that shortly. And but anyway, just go check it out. There's some great stuff there. And the 4th of July is coming up. Some of these patriotic designs, perfect for the 4th of July. Okay, part one of our interview with Rodney was a hoot. He's just a very cool, very fun, genuine guy. There's nothing fake about him whatsoever, which is why I think, he and Dad, they are kind of cut from the same cloth. So anyway, here's part two with Rodney. I'm sure he did want to talk to you because he was always really supportive of new artists that he kind of felt like there was a connection with, you know, like he and Travis Tritt, you know, they, you know, connected right off, you know, Eddie and Troy, you know, yeah. Artists like that, real, you know, artists that are real. And so, yeah, when there's somebody like that, you know, that, you know, he was going to definitely try to make a concerted effort to, you know, kind of, you know, sit and talk to him and, you know, get to know you a little bit.
Yeah, always, so. It's a rare gift. Like when I say I was looking at Charlie Daniels when I was five.
Yeah.
And I paid attention to him and the things that he said. And, you know, it's funny when he talked about making music, one of my saving pieces of advice that I took from him is he never said it took a whole lot of talent to this. He would say it takes grit and grace and hard work and tenacity.
Absolutely.
To make music.
Absolutely.
And I'm like, well, if that's what it takes, yeah. I can do that.
Well, Dad would tell you that he was not a natural musician. He said there are people that are much more naturally gifted than he is. He would still play scales, you know, every day. He kind of got out of it for a while, and then he I don't know, it was after when he had his stroke, he started kind of getting back into to try to get his you know, fingers all loosened up again. But, you know, he would play scales. He'd say he was not the best fiddle player out there. He held it wrong. He pushed down too hard on the strings. And he's like, if anybody wants to learn, you know, how to play fiddle the proper way, they should not look at me because I'm, you know, but it worked for him. I mean, it gave a distinct sound that, you know, you can hear a fiddle player and you can hear, okay, well, they're playing like the guys in the studios in Nashville play, very clean yeah. and stuff. And so, and Dad's, you know, sound was kind of nasty. It was funny. I think I can't remember if I mentioned this, talked to John Rich about this, but when he was doing the Music Mafia things, they had a show and there was this kid named Gary that was sitting in with them when they were playing. And the kid was like 13 or 14. He was playing way too much. He was playing all over everybody and stuff. And I'm listening to his tone and his sound and stuff. I said, this kid is a fan of Dad's.
because I could just tell, you know, he didn't sound clean and smooth and, you know,
had
proper.
Hair on it.
Yeah. And so anyway, I went up and I introduced myself after the show, and I thought the kid was going to hyperventilate.
That's awesome.
He literally took two steps back and was like,
That's awesome.
But, you know, so I had thought that maybe one of the first shows that you guys did was the Christmas for Kids in 2007, but you said that there was that Manhattan, Kansas show. But
yeah, that came back around, the Christmas for Kids, and then the year Charlie didn't get to do it, and they asked me to host it that year.
Yeah.
And it's just, there's been a couple of those situations that were just, I still can't believe it happened.
Yeah. But you did mention some advice. Was there any other things that you got from him besides the, you know, just it doesn't always take talent?
Yeah. So we did a few years ago when I was here before.
Yeah.
GAC had a program. It was after he was inducted as Opry member. They had a program called Into the Circle about Opry members and people who weren't Opry members.
Yeah.
So I got invited to come and do that on GAC with Charlie here. Yeah. And yeah, we just talked, man. And one of the things that stuck with me that he said, and since then I've seen that other people have said it, but not like him.
Right.
And it was that people will remember some of what you say, but they always remember how you make them feel.
Yeah.
And anybody that ever talked with him, he had that knack, man, of, I don't know if I've ever met another human that was as present as him. They say the key to happiness is just being present.
Yeah.
And man, when you talk to him, he was all there.
Mm-hmm.
And you never got an inch of an ego. And
no.
He, man, larger than life person.
Mm-hmm.
But he never, some people walk in a room and they just take up a lot of space.
Yeah.
But he never had this ego at all, ever with anybody. And he always made you feel like you were special. And man, that's that right there.
Yeah.
I mean, if I've ever picked up anything else from him, it was that.
Right.
It's when you talk to people, to value them.
Yeah. You know, I used to always kind of, my expectations of meeting somebody famous would definitely always be influenced by Dad. 9 times out of 10, I was, you know, disappointed, you know, because the egos, a lot of times, you know, they are, you know, they're there, and not always, you know, in a bad way, but yeah. So most of the time, if I measured what my expectations were of meeting an artist, in whatever genre, rock or whatever, that I would, you know, usually be kind of like, well, I guess that figures, you know, but you know, because they're not Dad. So.
The crazy thing is, people like that, and you meet them, and I've experienced it a lot too.
Mm-hmm.
You go, well, they're human.
Yeah.
There's something about him that didn't come off that way.
Yeah.
It's above and beyond, for sure.
Yeah.
I'm trying to think if there's anybody else I've met that kind of.
Yeah.
Like, Garth has that going
yeah.
a little bit where it's kind of, he's all in right
yeah.
then. Garth just remembers crazy stuff
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
You're. Uncle cousin's next door neighbor's name. But yeah, those things. And I'm terrible in a room full of artists talking
yeah.
about egos. I hate yeah. that stuff.
I do too, man.
Like, hey, how are you doing?
Yeah.
Enough about me. What do you think of me?
Yeah, right.
And so it kind of is tough.
Yeah.
But then when you experience, thank God, being around
yeah.
him a few times and,
well, and, you know, he's, you know, and except he did, you know, try to, there were some, you know, people he did kind of mentor. Blake and Brian, maybe not quite as much, but you know, he's still, the connection there with Corlew was mm-hmm. there. But, you know, he, you know, Red Atkins, you know, he had, you know, he actually did some sides on Red at
I didn't know that.
Yeah. And, course, Rhett's now probably the most famous for, you know, being, you know, Thomas Rhett's father. But
Well, he's I mean, he's written a couple of my hits.
Yeah. Oh, and songwriting.
He's a phenomenal. But, yeah.
But he's
it's actually Rhett and I sang Long Hair Country Boy for something.
Really?
Some event down in Georgia one time. It's like, look, what do you want to do? Let's do Long Hair Country Boy.
Atkins and Atkins.
Yep. So, you know, when I first came to town, that was my biggest hurdle for a while was every label that I met with, well, going to change your name because of Trace yeah. and Rhett
yeah.
at that time.
Right.
But I wasn't about to.
Right.
I was adopted, so I was lucky to have my name.
Yeah. Wow. Let's see. You also, you were at the Journey Home event that Dad did at the Palm one year.
Oh, yeah.
2014.
Yeah.
So
my wife and I were just talking about that.
Yeah.
Where the dude painted the picture upside down.
Yeah. Like I don't know if that was the picture, but he did. That's one of the ones he did. I don't remember where he did this one at. This was actually a recommissioned one because they did one at the show and they auctioned it off that night. And Dad said, you know, he wanted one. So it's one of the few things I've been able to hang on that is, you know, around here. And it just kind of feels right. Him kind of, you know, kind of watching over us when we're doing the show. But
yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, anything like that that I could ever do. I mean, I guess the most recent thing with General Huber.
That was, yeah, I was going to ask you about that because that was November of last year. And I guess it was rescheduled from November of 2020.
And the original date was 2020.
Yeah.
9/11.
Yeah.
This is when they were supposed to actually have the event.
Yeah.
And then COVID hit. And so it's for your mom and dad's place.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so
the,
we were
the Daniels, Charlie and Hazel Daniels, Military Families and Veterans and Military Family Center. It's kind of a mouthful, but
it's their, which leads me to another thing that Charlie did. It's basically a program that's set up at MTSU to, you know, further the education of veterans.
Yeah, kind of a one-stop shop for anything that a veteran or their families need.
Yep.
And Mom and I actually went to the Opry Tuesday night a week ago, I guess it was, and they did a salute to the troops, and the Daniels Center was all over the place. We sat with General Huber, and I realized that I had not been there except since when they made the announcement back, I don't know if that was 2016, 2017, whenever it was. Mm-hmm. And so I haven't actually been back. So I gotta go and actually check this place out for myself. But,
yeah, it's awesome. Yeah. Hopefully they're talking about when we're going to get to actually start doing the 9/11 concert every year for proceeds going
to the
center.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I'll definitely be there for that for sure. So wanted to you touched on her a second ago. You didn't fall in love with the farmer's daughter. You fell in love with the rocker's daughter.
Yeah, the songwriter's daughter. Yeah.
So Billy Rose's dad worked with John Bon Jovi a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's my office, Rose Falcon. Yeah. She's a songwriter. Artist, her own career.
Yeah.
And her dad, he was a pop artist years ago. And then Bon Jovi was a big fan of his. And it's interesting when you hear some of Bon Jovi's stuff, you actually can hear his voice.
Right.
And he still writes with him.
Yeah.
And Rose actually, I think she signed her first record to like 14 or something. Wow. And she did Columbia, New York, and Disney stuff. And I think she got tired of the treadmill a little bit. So her dad had moved to Nashville to write songs.
Yeah.
And they were from New York. And then she entertained some record deals through the years, but the BS of the business, she just was kind of done with it. So she just was writing. She's a blue collar everyday clock in songwriter. And then she had a number one on Eric Paisley. She wrote a song with him called Friday Night a few years ago. And we actually, during COVID, she sung a couple of duets with me on my Caught Up in the Country album. And then Mike Kerb called and said, you guys should do a project together. So we did, and it happened during COVID. It's the only time I could get her to.
Right.
She was stuck with me at home.
Yeah.
So recording at home, like I do, yeah. we did a EP together as a new artist.
Yeah.
It's Rod and Rose. It's completely different than what I do. And it was a blast. We actually got to tour a bunch of dates this year on it.
Oh, cool.
And yeah, it was. It's a blast. Well, I think it's something we're going to continue to do. We actually wrote a Christmas song. They asked for a couple Christmas tunes. So we recorded Winter Wonderland, mm-hmm. but then we wrote a song called Mary Had a Little Lamb.
Oh, wow.
And
that's a cool title.
When I told them the idea, yeah. they laughed. She'd laugh. She's like, really?
But it works. It totally works.
And we actually got to, we played it one time for Fox and Friends.
Yeah.
And that day, it was a trip. We played it once, and it took the number one spot from Mariah Carey.
Wow.
And that song was locked in there.
Yeah.
And so that was the only time we played the song was wow. once. And so it sat there for a minute. We could say we had a number yeah. one with it. And then this Christmas, we'll go and promote it some gotcha. More. Hopefully yeah. I think we're going to do a whole Christmas project together.
Well, that'd be cool. So Rod and Rose, we'll have to check that out. I was working at a record store back a million years ago, back when I was living in Knoxville, and Billy's album came out, and he had a song that was called Power Windows.
Yeah, man.
So I was familiar with Billy for a long time because this was late 80s, like probably 88, 89, and... then I knew somebody that knew Rose and actually saw, I think she and Billy did a show somewhere. I don't know if it was like, where Ace of Clubs was or something like that. Because I remember coming and seeing her perform.
Oh, the Sewing Circle, maybe. They used to play all the time like that. They had a cool thing.
Yeah, I mean, it was very laid back, the whole thing.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, I think it was called the Sewing Circle.
Okay, gotcha.
They used to do that all the time. They're so talented. She's easily one of the most talented people. And I'm not just saying that.
Oh, right.
One of the most talented people I've ever removed me loving her.
Yeah, right.
that I've ever known. I mean, she can do so many things, so many kinds of music. Her brain is so creative. She sees things differently. And I can honestly say I've written some of the best songs I've ever written with her.
Wow.
Because it goes to another place. Wow. It's a blast when we get to work together. And I love it. Hopefully it's something we can just kind of always do.
Well, I guess we'll kind of start wrapping things up. But I wanted to say, since we're talking about songs, what would you say your favorite song of Dad's would be?
Oh, wow.
I mean, it can be something obscure, just whatever, something that just really resonates with you.
I say Long Hair Country Boy because it, great, great songs. I mean, that went down to, there's Sample Man, there's, oh my goodness. His songs, the thing his songs do, it's like when I'm singing, and I didn't write it, so I'm not tooting my own horn. When I'm singing, If You're Going Through Hell, that song reveals something new to me. I've sung it 10 million times, but something comes out of a different place. Long Hair Country Boy does that as well. It just takes me to a different place.
Yeah.
Listening to it, I got in the truck. My middle kid is 4. It's Ryder, and he's a music dude. So he went, it was just me and him going out on the road last weekend. We got in the truck going to the bus, and I had to crank up. Said, all right, let's get her mind right. Mm-hmm. So I put on Simple Man and Long Hair Country Boy. And I turned the radio down I was going to order something fast food going to the bus with him. And he said, I can't hear my song. So then he asked me again for Simple Man. Can you play Simple Man?
Well, there you go. Rodney raising his kids right. Right on the CDB music. I did want to touch on real quick. We talked about Ted real quick. Ted Hewitt, who co-produced
everything.
Yeah, Probably one of the nicest, quiet, unassuming guys you'd ever see. I knew him from, you know, he plays in the Fab, the Beatles tribute band. Yeah, and I knew him just, you know, from around town and stuff. And the guy's a phenomenal musician, producer, and like I said, but you would never know it. He's so quiet and humble, and you know, you would know that he's produced some major hits.
Absolutely. So, yeah. He knows music upside down and backwards. Yeah. I mean, he understands the music theory side of things, but he gets what a hit has to have this energy.
Yeah.
And he would not quit on a song. Right. If he believed it's a hit, that's the beauty of him. He just would not quit until it had, like, watching you. Yeah. He just kept stacking guitars. Great musician. Yeah. Thank God. I would not be here if it wasn't for Tim. Yeah. That's for sure.
Well, and you were talking about playing, which song was it over? You played over and over. Was it Going Through Hell, I guess? You know, people always ask Dad, you know, or people will say, he's got to get tired of playing Devil Went Down to Georgia. And it's just like, you know, it's, you know, you got to, you know, he loved playing it. He would, you know, he'd try and, you know, I guess, you know, each night you can go, okay, I'm going to try and do it better next time and just keep, you know, doing it. But he, you know, you got to dance with who brung you, you know.
Yeah, so, one thing I heard Charlie say, he didn't say it to me, but I heard him say it and I took it to heart, is, yes, you may have played that song 10 million times, but that night there's somebody that loves that song and it's going to be the first time they've heard that song live.
Yeah.
This is the night. So it's the first time. So play it like it's the first time, and the bus is going off the cliff on the way home.
Right. It's not about you. It's about the audience.
Oh, so, absolutely. Yeah. That's the only reason I could, like I said, I did not want to get up in front of people and sing. I finally realized if I record songs that they sing, then we're singing together. I'm not a stander and I'm going to sing at you.
Yeah.
Let's do this together.
Yeah.
Another thing, I want to say this.
Okay.
With Charlie. The reason, look, I've done some bizarre, crazy, beautiful USO trips, military stuff, and it goes back to Charlie saying, have you done some overseas stuff, soldiers? I said, I have not. I can't figure out how to get into it.
Really?
And so he pushed me in some directions that opened up.
Judy Seal?
Oh, I can't remember now.
Stars for Stripes?
I did some Stars for Stripes stuff. The Afghanistan trips was USO.
Yeah, okay.
But, man, him opening that door for me, I actually went to some of the military hospitals right after. I just asked. You just got to ask.
Yep.
And by doing that, it opened some doors to – then it's a major part of my drive.
And they really appreciate that.
Oh, yeah. But he led the charge on that stuff, man. Yeah. He made it important.
Well, he was a patriot through and through.
Absolutely. So. None better.
Well, man, I appreciate you coming out here, and this was great. And well, be sure to check out Rod and Rose, and hopefully
I'm finishing a new solo album right now.
That was what I was going to ask you
it's
about.
Coming. So yeah, man.
Okay, well, awesome. Good to see you.
Thanks, buddy.
Take care. I want to thank Rodney again for coming out to the Sticks to talk about Dad. Just had a great time. He is a genuine, real, down-to-earth country boy. He and Dad are cut from the same cloth in that respect. But anyway, Rodney is touring. Be sure and check him out. Check out Rod and Rose. He and his wife, Rose Falcon, have this duo that he talked about. And they got some EPs. Check it out wherever you get your music streaming. You know, they're also doing some shows. They were at CMA Music Fest recently. So anyway, check them out. You'll be glad you did. Okay, I've been telling you we only have a few of these left. Just sold another one right before I started recording this. But anyway, you can save 20%. On the limited edition Charlie Daniels Life Fiddle with the code CharlieFiddle, CharlieFiddle, all together, no space. and use that at checkout to save 20%. It's beautiful. It's painted gold colored. The engraved pictures of Dad when he was young, and when he was older, and Mom and I signed next to the engraved replica of his signature, but there's replica lyrics that come with it. There's a signed book of soapboxes. Dad actually signed a whole bunch of these soapbox books quite a while ago. We found them up in the attic, and so each fiddle includes a book signed by Dad. We have laminated backstage passes from previous tours. We have photos. We have the portrait print, which is beautiful, suitable for framing. Full moon button, a bandana that Dad used on stage, that is extremely rare. The 2016 Charlie Daniels campaign style t-shirts, and a fiddle bow that was one that Dad was going to use on stage that was being prepped and he never got to use, and some autograph pictures that we have found also. So it comes, and replica handwritten lyrics, actual pictures of Dad's handwritten lyrics. So those are also a bonus, but it's the ultimate gift for the ultimate CDB fan. Get them before they're gone. They are going to be gone soon. store.charliedaniels.com. Okay, here we go. You've been waiting for it. Seems like I should have a drum roll or something going on here. We have a special announcement. You're hearing it here first, nowhere else. We have two big announcements coming. The first is the Duets Project, which was released last year. It was shortly after the anniversary of Dad's passing. It's coming to vinyl, and it is a beautiful package. The vinyl, it's a two-disc set because there's a lot of songs on it, and it's white vinyl. It's absolutely gorgeous. And it's available at Walmart. The CD of Duets was originally exclusively available at Walmart, and it might still be, I'm not sure. But the vinyl will be exclusively at Walmart as well. And you can pre-order it from the website right now. If you go to walmart.com, search for Charlie Daniels and Duets and vinyl, you'll find it there. It says that if you pre-order it now, it will arrive by August 27th. So that's something to look forward to. It has duets with Darius Rucker, Dolly Parton, Vince Gill, Hal Ketchum. There's a ton of artists that are on here. Trying to think of who else. The Grascals, Garth Brooks does a song with Dad. Anyway, it's very cool, and vinyl has made such a return here in the last few years. I mean, who would have thought, kids could walk around with every song they ever been created on their phones now, but people are back into vinyl now, which is cool. Don't get me wrong, I loved my vinyl. But anyway, that's announcement number one. Now, announcement number two, hold on to your hats. The very first Volunteer Jam was October 4th, 1974, and it was supposed to be a live recording session for No Place to Go and Orange Blossom Special for the Fire on the Mountain album. Dad just for fun invited some of his friends. Dickie Betts came, some of the guys from Marshall Tucker came, and they had they decided to jam afterwards, and history was made. Very cool. The jams continued over the years, from really off and on until the early 90s, and then they started back up again in 2015. But because the only two songs you ever heard were from the Fire on the Mountain album were No Place to Go and Orange Blossom Special, did you ever wonder what the rest of the set sounded like? Well, you will soon be able to know what it sounded like, because Volunteer Jam 1, 1974, is coming soon. And by the time this podcast is on, has dropped, one of the songs you'll be able to find it on Spotify, Apple Music, Pandora, any platform. It might even be available for download on iTunes if you still do that sort of thing. But Long Hair Country Boy live version is going to be available on, let's see, I think it's going to be available like on the 23rd. So this podcast will be, have dropped by the 24th, I think. So there you go. And a July 15th, another single will drop. It's a cover of Jambalaya by Hank Williams. And there's that to look forward to. And the entire album is going to be available August 26th. So it's very cool that this bit of history is finally going to be available. I've been like dying to talk about this for the longest time, but I didn't have enough information. And the information is finally there. I can tell you when the digital copies will be available. I don't know about the CDs yet. I'm sure we will have them, and I'm sure we will have them at the website, and they'll be available, you know, whenever I know, I'll let you guys know. I promise you. But anyway, so there you go. You know, I told you guys new music was coming, but y'all were doubting me. I know. I see how you are. But it's going to be worth the wait. I promise you, this is going to be extremely cool. That's all we have time for all things CDB, the podcast, new releases, which I told you were coming, merchandise, and more. Go to charliedaniels.com and be sure to subscribe so you know when the podcast drops and you get to, you know, you won't have to guess. And then, and if you go to Apple Podcasts, you get to see me. Or if you go to charliedaniels.com/podcast, the link's there as well. But anyway, this is Charlie Daniels Jr., and let's all make the day count. And don't forget, Benghazi, it ain't going away, nor is Afghanistan. Ukraine, inflation's out of control. That definitely ain't going away. But, you know, we need to talk to that guy, Brandon. He seems to know what's going on. So let's find him.